Good morning, learners. I am Dr. Sanjana Vij, Assistant Professor, Amity Institute of Education, New Delhi. Today, I have the topic to discuss with you is selecting an appropriate teaching learning methods, which is very, very important. We all are into teaching fraternity, so it is very important that we should know what all teaching methods we have to select before teaching. So I will just start my lecture that what are the teaching methods? What do you understand by teaching methods? Teaching methods are nothing but the mechanism of classroom transactions. A teaching method may be visualized as a structural representation of the content or concepts. Its role in the teaching learning situation is critical, as the achievement of the teaching learning objectives depend largely on the teaching methods employed. What are the effective methods we as a teacher can use to enhance our teaching learning process? Now for that, there are various methods that have been found more effective in maximizing learners' participation in the teaching learning process. It could be directly or it could be indirectly. For example, project methods, field trips, then games, brainstorming, discussion, experimental investigations, and so on. There are so many methods, effective methods, which a teacher can feel to inculcate the students' learning process. And they can include all these learning process, all these methods to enhance the teaching learning process more into the students. Mixed approach. Now, it is said that an effective teacher is able to communicate well and should use a mixed approach. Now, here, what do you mean by mixed approach? Mixed approach means it should be the combination of teaching learning methods. So, an appropriate methods could be many, like as I have discussed earlier also. So, when the teacher is doing the combination of all those methods, whereas lecture method is also there and demonstration method is also there and activity method is also there. So that is known as a mixed approach. So selecting an appropriate method is very, very important, and it always depends upon two key factors. The first one is the nature of the content, and the second is the preferred learning styles of your students, that how they will grasp easily, how they will understand easily, how they will learn easily. So the teacher has to use that approach in the class which fits to each and every child. So the first point, as I discussed you earlier, the nature of the content. The nature of the content being transacted and dealt in the class with patiently. As a practicing teacher, we would appreciate that it should be based on the nature of the topic being discussed in the classroom. The teacher needs to find a suitable teaching learning methods. Some topics, like defining certain scientific terms, may require elaborate explanation only. They may not require any activity in that, or they may not require any collaborative learning in that. So in that case, lecture method may be found very effectively. So it is not always important that you should include activities in between when there is no need. So where defining certain scientific terms, only elaborate explanations will help, and only lecture methods will be more effectively. But while others, like interconvention about the three states of water, may require that you take your students to the science laboratory and demonstrate the same. Similarly, there could be many other topics where you need the practical approach to be given to the student. So for that, you may require that you need to take to the students to that particular area or to that particular location, so that they can have a feel of that laboratory or the demonstration of that particular activity for the same. Similarly, a number of social science concepts, for example, seasons and food choices, may require that children are taken to the gardens, to the vegetable gardens, or to the fruit markets, where they should be engaged themselves in observing serving, etc. So they can observe minutely that how these people are doing, so the concept should be more clear to them. So it all depends upon the nature of the content. Preferred learning styles of the student, which is the second point and most important point, that all students have different abilities and different style of learning and different style of taking the content into the mind. So all students have different intellectual abilities. They think and learn in totally different manner. So there are totally different ways of classifying differences in learning styles. Some learning styles like left and right brain thinkers. Second, auditory, visual and kinesthetic learners. Third could be activist, reflectors, theorist and pragmatist. So there are many people having different intellectual abilities and different way of thinking and learning. So the teacher has to see that through which style she has to teach. Now there are different teaching strategies also. Each learner will have a preferred way in which to process information. The key consideration for us as a teachers is not only to rely on only one teaching strategy. It is very important to remember that some students don't learn very well by just listening and taking notes. Every individual have their own intellectual abilities, so they have different styles through which they learn. Some may have more limited attention span than others and may like activities in the class. Some students love to learn through the help of activities or with the help of collaborative learnings or with the help of hands-on experiences. So understanding the many ways in which people learn is very, very crucial and very, very important when selecting an appropriate teaching learning methods. Now there are many methods, many appropriate teaching methods, for example, observations, creative expressions, field visits, projects, small group discussions, experiments, and problem solving. Now, I will take all these points one by one to elaborate further. The first point was the observation method. Now, we all know that observation method is a method in which we just observe, and observations are the basics of learning and understanding. Many researchers say that the student learns by observing the things. They learn, they observe their peer groups and they learn many social skills by observing them. So it is said that one of the ways in which an infant learns is mainly observation. Observing things around, analyzing them and drawing learning from such observation is the core of constructing and reconstructing knowledge based on one's experience. Let's take an example of my bird book. Let the students go out and observe different birds and note the variation in colors, the variation in their sizes, and the other external features and record them. Let them identify the different basic features of a bird, such as size, color, their beak, their body, their neck, their head, their feet, their wings, their tails, their features, their eyes, their nose, everything. Let them observe. Teach the student how they can draw these different features using simple diagrams. The student should now draw the diagrams of the birds observing using all these form patterns. The student should color the diagrams using crayons as close to the color of the bird as possible. The student should stick all the drawings in the scrapbook. So planning and preparation for observation is very, very important. That what type of settings, activities or environmental traits are to be assessed through observations. So planning is very important. Then actual observation, the better methods and techniques should be used for observations depending upon the purpose and availability of the resources and environmental situations. Now analyzing and interpretation, which is very, very important for any activity or any observations. What has been observed and recorded is subjected to a close analysis for deriving the necessary interpretation. If the child has not closely observed, then analysis and interpretation done process is very difficult. So analysis and interpretation is very important. Then comes generalization of the result. The interpretation made and results arrived is very important and arrived at when we are using, establishing, generalizing opinions, facts and principles. So the tools used for observations could be like worksheets, schedules, checklists, rating scales and scorecards. So all these things we can use when we are in the process of observation method. Now there are many advantages of also observation method, like it encourages children to explore their environment, develops observation skills among the child. It encourages students to see, think and establish connections. The students are able to infer similarities and the differences. The acquired knowledge is from real and concrete situations and others. So it satisfies and develop curiosity among the students, which is very, very important. Curiosity is very important in the child and in the teacher. If curiosity is not there, the whole thing will be vanished. So it creates curiosity among students. So second point is creative expressions. It is important to help nurture young children's creativity through a rich learning environment of visual and performing arts. Such techniques can help teacher to engage her students in art and craft, music, dance, and drama. In other words, we can call them as a co-curricular activities also, in which the student can create their expressions and show it. So such techniques like art and craft, music, drama, arts, all these comes under the category of creative expressions. Thus, a teacher may plan lessons with activities that aim to nurture expressiveness, creativity, and imagination among the young learners in the class. Now, creative expressions, they are into variety of forms. For example, writing. Student can be asked to create poetry. They can ask to sing a song. They can ask to act in a drama. They can write stories. They can write essays. They can compile the collection of relevant materials from other resources. That is also the form of creative expressions. Graphic arts. It includes drawing and paintings, making collage and sculptures, taking photographs, designing posters, banners, etc. So through these also, they are expressing themselves. These are called as a creative expressions. Then comes music. Now children respond to songs that inspires, energize and link them to environmental messages. Feeling can be expressed effectively by music. So they can express themselves through music, through poetry, through drama, through any other variety of forms. Movement and dance is also another variety of forms. Non-verbal art often encourages students to express those thoughts and feelings which they do not like to say. So sometimes the students are little hesitate to speak in front of public directly. So they can always encourage to express their feelings through movements and dance. Puppetry. Environmental messages can be transformed with the help of puppetry. For this, training is required and special skills are also required. Now, there are few tips for facilitating creative expressions, like promote creative expressions in the small groups. Because once the group become very large, then it is very difficult to promote these kind of expressions. So always prefer to have a small group because it helps the children to overcome their inhibitions. So provide choices of creative expression mediums such as visual arts, creative dramatics, music, movements according to the student's skills and interest. Encourages teamwork, yet give individual attention to each and every child. It helps in building self-confidence and creative thinking self. Create a non-stressed, non-competitive atmosphere in the class. But when it is a competitive atmosphere in the class, then sometimes the students don't get up to the mark. So we have to create that kind of an environment in the class that they should not be stressed much. There should be non-competitive atmosphere in the class. Create a fun-filled learning environment for the children. Next is small group discussions. Group discussions is always a technique that can facilitate cooperative learning among children, because small group discussion has another name that is known as a cooperative learning or collaborative learning. Group discussions provide learning opportunities to students in developing analytical and communication skills. As the name says, small group discussions are group exercises which can be used as a teaching strategy to influence learning through engaging of peer groups. So the teacher can make a small groups, and they can give the topics to the students, and they can have a small group discussions. Now there are steps to organize a small group discussions. Teacher organize the class into small groups of about 4 to 6 members, or maybe if the class size is more, then she can increase the number of participants to 7 to 8 each. The teacher can announce a problem statement or the questions to the students or to the groups. Basically, they can make 6 to 7 groups depending upon the number of the students in the class. The teacher can make them the group, and then she can assign or she can announce the problem statements or question to that particular groups. And groups can be provided 10 to 15 minutes for discussion. They all can sit on a round table or any place where they feel comfortable, and they can just discuss with their peer groups, and each individual in the group shares his or her own views on the topic, and which can be followed by the all group members discussing the concerns, creative arguments, changing opinions, etc. So each group spends a few minutes reviewing, consolidating and recording the opinions, points and ideas generated. And in the last, each group reports to the entire class, which means that each group can give the presentation in the form of reporting, or they can just report to the entire group. As a teacher, it is very important that she should keep few points in mind while having this group small group discussions. Every discussion should be goal oriented. It should have educational purpose linked to the subject. Topic is relevant for the class, should be relevant for the age group, should be interested and as per the syllabus. Children have sufficient information about the topic in order to participate actively in the discussion. If they don't have any information prior to the activity, then that activity or that discussion will be of no use. So if as a teacher you want that discussion to be fruitful, then sufficient information should be informed to the participants before the activity or before the discussion. Children are able to express their thoughts in a language that they feel comfortable with. So it is always advisable that they should not be forced to use different languages to express their presentations. So in whatever language they are comfortable, they can express their thoughts in that particular language. So effective group discussion is very, very important, and for that the teacher needs to see not only these points, but also she should provide an opportunity for each student of the group to become a leader. It should not like that always one student become leader. So the teacher should give that opportunity to each and every child that they can become a leader in that particular group. It depends upon situation to situation, problem to problem, questions to questions. So while creating groups, the teacher has to ensure that the composition of the group is balanced. Each group may have different personalities, and she has to make that kind of balancing groups so that the results can be seen among the personality of each and every child. Teacher act as a consultant to the group and help, guide, orient student and facilitate the exchange of ideas. Ask why or how questions, and for short answers, ask students to elaborate. Do not fear silence. The teacher should not always fear for silence. This may be the most difficult thing to do, but it is absolutely essential. Provide positive feedback for participation. Thank the students for their contribution. Manage both process and content. Good discussion is as much important as the process of the content. Next is projects for environmental education. Projects is also a teamwork and act as a related to the real life activities undertaken to solve an emerging or felt problems or to realize some useful or purposeful objectives. It involves a series and variety of activities and is executed in the real life context, social environment and natural settings. This is a beautiful quote given by Kilpatrick that a project is a wholehearted, purposeful activity proceeding in a social environment. Nowadays, what is happening that students, when the students are given this task of making a project, so they will just jump to the technology and from there they can just have cut, copy, paste information and they can present their project. So that is not the right way of doing the project, because a project, as Kilpatrick is saying, that it is a wholehearted, purposeful activity. So the student has to put in the whole heart in that and they have to do that activity purposefully. Now when the student is doing this activity wholehearted, then it has many advantages also. The project method of learning provides an opportunity to the children to apply and practice what they have learned. So that's the project helps to link between theory and practice. So it is a method that helps children to discover the interdisciplinary linkages, which is very, very important in the case of environmental education, a composite area of study. The project method also enables teachers to enhance a number of competency skills among the learners, like research, observation, analysis, interpretation, interpersonal skills, problem solving, resource management, and most important skill is planning and execution. So projects are very good for getting children work closely together in their common real life setting. But it has few limitations also if we don't work it properly. Like, teachers need high order of preparation. The teacher has to be well prepared for the project methods. And they have to put in so much of hard work. So it comes under limitations that they need high order of preparation. They are required to work as a guide and facilitator during planning, execution, evaluation and recording of the project. And all this process is a very time consuming process. So teacher has to give lots of time and may need some resources as well to follow these project methods. Children may be overwhelmed with the doing and the actions part of the project, and if not supported by teachers in consolidating the various learnings, children may fail to comprehend the work and learning deprived. So the teacher has to act as a guide and facilitator, and she has to do lots of planning, lots of execution, lots of hard work in evaluating and recording of the project. That comes under the limitations of the project method. Now, the teacher has a major role when it comes to the project method. While using the project method of learning with the students, the teacher will be required to have a very clear time plan matched to the school timetable. She has to see the school timetable, and sometimes if the activities or project methods go beyond their schedule, so that planning she has to do beforehand. The teacher must ensure the linkages of syllabus and curriculum, and she should have a good knowledge and insight in the subject of research and action. The teacher need to constantly change her roles between that of an expert, a guide, mentor, as well as a learner. So wherever the requirement is there, she should fit to that particular parameter. The teacher needs to arouse inquisitiveness and interest among learners, which is very important, and be a self-motivated guide. The teacher needs to ensure a positive and democratic learning environment. The next point is visits for learning. We all have heard about field visits a lot, and they are really a great fun and a great source of learning also. So a field trip, or you can say as excursions, is a journey by a group of people to a place away from their normal environment. So visiting to zoo, gardens, parks, museums, they all are the part of school life. And visiting to these picnics and places, these are all educational opportunities given by the schools. And we as a teacher can make these picnics into joyful learning outcomes. So any of these can provide rich opportunities for first-hand exposure and experiences. The challenge is to transform these into exciting, thought-provoking and educational opportunities. Properly planned out-of-class experiences can help to enrich and complement what is taught in the classroom. So visit for learning can develop various skills like observations, investigations, monitoring, mapping, collecting of data and analyzing it, critical thinking skills and problem solving. And here the teacher role is also very important because she has to plan lot of activities, planning a variety of appropriate activities so that it should be enjoyable and it should be educational also. So very important not to overstress on the educational part and maintain an informal atmosphere. So field trips are very helpful in linking the real world to the classroom, visited to the places of environment concerning, provided opportunities to the learners as a means of observing and experiencing the real life environment. And it has enough scope for building environmental awareness, stimulating participation and develop investigating skills in the learners. Next is problem solving. Problem solving is again a method aimed to help the students in arriving at the solution or alternative solution for a given problems. This is a very effective approach for all the students and they experience it at well. It prepares them better to participate in democratic group discussion and solving open-ended problems. Next is experiments, which are very, very helpful in enabling children understand abstract concepts. It helps developing scientific temper, hypothesis, and discover the explore. It enhances the skills of observations and analytical thinking, and it provides practical knowledge in enabling children apply the theoretical knowledge gained in the learning process. So to conclude, individuals have preferred learning styles. There is no one method and material for making learning process successful and effective. As a teacher, our understanding of various learning methods for use in different learning situations will enable us to facilitate our class in the varied and interesting manner. So a teacher can thus create a good learning environment for her children by using mixed learning methods and techniques based on the concept being learned, the learner and the classroom resources. So it is important that teaching methods used for environmental education, it allows children to work together, to examine multiple viewpoints, to link concept of the test books to their real lives and take a positive actions. So this is all about different teaching methods. I hope you have gained by my discussion. Thank you.